Good day and welcome to the Q2 FY22 earnings conference call of Jubilant Ingrevia Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Pavleen Singh Taneja, Associate Director, Investor Relations, Jubilant Ingrevia Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being with us on our Q2 and half year FY22 earnings conference call of Jubilant Ingrevia Limited. I would like to remind you that some of the statements made on the call today could be forward-looking in nature, and a detailed disclaimer in this regard has been included in the press release and earnings release that has been shared on our website. On the call today, we have Mr. Shyam Bhartia, Chairman, Mr. Hari Bhartia, Co-Chairman, Mr. Rajesh Srivastava, CEO and Managing Director, Mr. Prakash Chandra Bisht, CFO, Jubilant Ingrevia Limited, and Mr. Arvind Chokhany, Group CFO. I now invite Mr. Shyam Bhartia to share his comments, please.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Q2 FY22 earnings conference call. With immense pleasure, I would like to announce that we have delivered yet another strong financial performance in Q2 FY22 and reported our highest ever revenue during quarter and half year ended 30th September 2021. Supply disruptions from China is coming to our advantage, due to which we are witnessing strong demand in most of our products. That is giving us an opportunity to increase our share with global customers. While on the sourcing side, we are having negligible dependence on China. We are finding unprecedented increase in almost all the input raw materials, fuels like coal and gas and logistics cost. However, our business team is confident to pass on the incremental costs by working closely with the customers. In our specialty chemical segment, we witnessed strong growth across the products led by growing demand from pharmaceuticals and agrochemical customers. In nutrition and health solution, the demand of vitamin B3 has been stable and prices started to increase in vitamin B3. We continue to work to improve our market share in niche segments like food and cosmetics. In life science chemical segment, we witnessed healthy demand from pharmaceutical and agrochemical customers, resulting in volume growth in all the products. I'm happy to announce that we have reduced the net debt further by rupees 193 crores during Q2 FY22. Looking ahead, we are excited with the growth opportunities in our businesses, and we are fully committed to realize them. We have developed a strong product pipeline using in-house R&D, our technical expertise into various chemistry platforms, and long-standing relationship with global pharmaceutical and agrochemical customers, including innovators. We are prioritizing and investing in several growth CapEx in next two, three years to launch these products to achieve our growth target of doubling the revenue by FY26 from the base year of FY21. With this, I now hand over to Rajesh to discuss about the business in detail.
Thank you, Mr. Bhartia. A very good evening to all of you.
At the onset, I hope you all and your loved ones are safe and healthy. I would like to welcome you all for joining Q2 FY22 quarterly investor call of Jubilant Ingrevia Limited. It gives me immense pleasure to report a healthy financial and operational performance of Jubilant Ingrevia Limited for the second quarter and half year ended 30th September 2021. Revenue during the quarter was 1,223 crore, demonstrating a growth of 56% year-on-year, driven by 17% growth in specialty chemicals, 43% nutrition and health solutions, and 84% in life science chemical business segments. EBITDA during the quarter was at rupees 202 crore, up 44% year-on-year, led by significant growth in life science chemicals business segments and also by nutrition and health solution business. As highlighted by Mr. Bhartia in his speech about the strong demand in most of our products due to supply disruptions from China and logistic disturbances, we at Jubilant Ingrevia are fully committed to realize them into our business growth using our long-standing relationships and proven track record with global customers. Now let me take you through the updates on all the three business segments. Specialty chemicals. Specialty chemicals revenue grew by 17% on year-on-year basis, driven by higher volume across the product segment. Major demand surge was witnessed in pharmaceutical, consumer, nutrition, and industrial end-use segments. EBITDA remained flat in value terms, while EBITDA margin declined due to volatility in price of input cost. Overall demand scenario continues to be strong. Domestic demand also improved due to shift of some of the pharmaceutical and agrochemical end product customer from China to India, leading to increased market share. However, amid the challenging environment, we successfully maintained our global leading positions in pyridine and its 11 derivatives, and in several products improved our market share globally. Nutrition and health solution. Nutrition and health solution revenue grew by 43% on year-on-year basis, driven by higher volume and prices, and the EBITDA margin were 19.5% during the quarter. During the quarter, due to reduction in African swine fever in China, there has been strong demand of vitamin B3, niacinamide and niacin. Therefore, we were in a position to place higher volume both on quarter-on-quarter as well as on year-on-year basis. We also continued to focus on improving our market share in niche segments like food and cosmetics, and we are also focusing to enhance our market share in North American markets. Demand in animal nutrition segment remained strong, primarily driven by recovery in poultry and aquaculture. We continue making efforts to increase share of our specialty premixes through various initiatives. Life science chemicals. We delivered another outstanding performance in our life science chemicals segment with 84% growth in revenue and 160% growth in EBITDA on year-on-year basis, along with a healthy margin of 13.8% during the quarter. This superior performance was based on account of favorable market condition driven by disruption in Europe and China market driven by force majeure by key supplier of acetyl products. We witnessed acetic acid sharp price increase during the end of the quarter. However, the average price during the quarter were lower in comparison to Q1 FY22. Acetic anhydride demand remained strong during the quarter. We managed to place better volume of acetic anhydride during the quarter, both on quarter-on-quarter as well as on year-on-year basis. We also maintained domestic market leadership of acetic anhydride and increased market presence in Europe, Americas, and rest of the world. During the beginning of the quarter, demand of ethyl acetate was lower, which improved significantly during the later part of the quarter. Therefore, with respect to better demand, especially during later part of the quarter, we could place higher volume of ethyl acetate in India as well as in Europe on quarter-on-quarter basis. Specialty ethanol market demand also continued to be strong, which has resulted in higher sales volume on year-on-year basis and stable on quarter-on-quarter basis. Growth plans and CapEx. Progress of first phase of diketene CapEx is as per schedule and is expected to be commissioned during the quarter January to March 2022. During the year so far, we have already committed investments worth rupees 450 crore for following growth CapEx. At peak capacity, these investments are expected to generate additional annual revenue of rupees 900 to 1000 crore at prevailing prices. Number one, CDMO GMP facility at Bharuch, which is expected to be operation during the quarter April to June 2022. Three multi-purpose plants of specialty chemical, which is expected to be in operation during the quarter July to September 2022. Food grade acetic acid, which is expected to be in operation during the quarter April to June 2022. Acetic anhydride plant, which is expected to be in operation during the quarter January to March 2023. Agroactive phase 1, which is expected to be in operation during the quarter January to March 2023. Our expected capex cash outflow for the year will be in the range of rupees 350 crore. Outlook. Demand of most of our products is expected to remain strong in H2. Though input costs are increasing, our business teams are confident to pass on the incremental cost by working closely with customers. With this, I now hand over to Prakash to discuss the financials.
Thank you, Rajesh. A very good evening to everyone, and thank you for joining us on Q2 FY22 quarterly earning conference call. I would now highlight the company's financial performance during the quarter ended 30th September 2021. I would like you to recall that the life science ingredient business of Jubilant Pharmova demerged into Jubilant Ingrevia Limited effective 1st February 2021. And in FY21, our results comprise results only for 2 months of operation starting from 1st February 2021. However, similar to earlier quarters, to provide the comprehensive picture of the operation of the company on a continuing basis, the results for the previous periods has been presented on pro forma basis in this investor deck and also during the call by deriving the same from the published results related to discontinued operation of LSI segment of Jubilant Pharmova Limited. The details in this regard are provided in the investor deck and note 5 of our published results, and we request you to go through the same. Revenue from operations during Q2 FY22 was at rupees 1,223 crores as compared with rupees 784 crores in Q2 last year. Similarly, revenue from operations during H1 FY22 was at 2,367 crores as compared with the 1,520 crores in half year last year. The EBITDA during the quarter was 202 crores as compared with 140 crores in Q2 FY21, with margins at 16.5% during the quarter. Similarly, EBITDA for H1 FY22 was at rupees 490 crores as compared with rupees 267 crores during H1 FY21. Margins were at 20.7% during H1 FY22 as compared with the 17.6% for the same period last year. Depreciation and amortization expenses during the quarter was at 31 crores. Finance cost during the quarter was significantly lower at 7 crores versus 17 crores in Q2 FY21, a reduction of 59% YOY on account of repayment of debt and the lower interest rate. The tax expenses for Q2 were higher at 54 crores on account of higher profits. The cash tax is expected to remain at 17.5% during FY22. PAT during the quarter was 111 crores as against 77 crores in Q2 FY21. Similarly, PAT for H1 FY22 was rupees 279 crores as against rupees 130 crores PAT in H1 FY21. The company maintained the steady deleveraging in Q2 FY22 also. The gross debt was reduced by 193 crores in Q2 FY22. Gross debt as on 30th September 21 stands at 263 crores as against 457 crores as on 30th June 21. The company's net debt stood at rupees 193 crores as at 30th September 2021, a reduction of 193 crores from 30th June 2021. Net debt to EBITDA ratio further improved at 0.2 times from the earlier level of 0.5 times as on 30th June 2021 on the basis of trailing 12 months EBITDA. During the quarter, we also divested our stake in Safe Food for a consideration of US$18.2 million, approximately rupees 134 crores, consequent upon its merger with another company. With this, I would like to conclude our opening remark. We will now be happy to address any questions that you may have.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Anyone who would like to ask a question, you may press star and one at this time. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Jason Jones from Ashika Group. Please go ahead.
Yeah, so thanks for taking my question, sir. Just wanted some color on the life science chemicals business. Now, as we have seen that this business, the margins tend to be a little volatile. So in 1Q, the margins were around 27%, which has dropped to around 14% in 2Q. And I know in previous calls you have spoken about, you know, looking at this segment from an absolute EBITDA point of view. So just wanted your sense on what are the long-term sustainable margins for this business. And you also spoke about a force majeure event. So just wanted to know if, you know, everything goes back to normalcy, what's a long-term sustainable margin for this business?
So as we have explained in the first quarter that in life science chemical business, we had certain favorable conditions. Plus, in the first quarter, there was a significant increase in acetic acid price vis-a-vis the past quarter of Q4. And we had certain benefits on inventory. So the second quarter performance is close to the normal performance. Though the prices settled down during the quarter, but at the fag end of the quarter, acetic acid price further went up. But as a whole, quarter two was more or less a normalized performance. Yes, there is a disruption from China, but in any way, these products of life science chemicals really do not come from China to India. So the Indian market is totally dependent on Indian manufacturers. So more or less Q2, you can assume, is more or less a normal performance.
Okay, sure. Thanks for that, sir. And so when I look at your gross margins, now when you have a dip in the gross margins of around 850 bits, quarter on quarter, when I refer to it. So the gross margins have dropped 850 bits to around 40.9% in 2Q, which clearly shows, clearly points out to a rise in input costs, and you have highlighted that. So I just wanted to know, and also acetic acid prices also fell by 20% in Q2 from around $1,200 to around $950 in Q2 average. So just wanted some color on this as well. I mean, what's the exact reason for such a sharp drop in gross margin of 850 bits?
Prakash, will you?
Yeah, So the drop in the gross margin, if you would see that there is a raw material price increase, which we are passing on. But if you would see that the overall sales price, that has gone up, when you are comparing it with Q1, it's by 6.9%, whereas the raw material prices have gone by 24.6%, so which is also reflecting in our gross margin. So mathematically, if 100 rupees has increased and you pass on to 100 rupees in sales price, as a percentage, when you would see, it would come down. So that is the reason why it is reflecting in the gross margin.
Okay. So, sir, do you mean it will get passed on with a lag? And, you know, is that, what you mean? Will it get passed on? Will it take some time for, you know, to pass on the input, increase in input prices?
So what I'm trying to explain you is that in our life science chemical business, when you pass on the raw material price increase in the value of sales, since the value of sales as a percentage, it would always change. So it would not always be the linear percentage.
Okay. Sure. And my final question would be, you know, I just wanted to know something about the potential for the pyridine's chemistry in India and globally. Now, I understand that you have a significant market share in 11 derivatives and a significant scale as well. So just some color on the pyridine's chemistry in India and the you know, I see that the building blocks for specialty chemicals start from your life science chemicals business, especially being acetic anhydride and ethyl acetate. So could you talk about some color on the pyridine's potential for pyridine's chemistry and the integration of life science chemicals into specialty chemicals and how you could, look at, growing that aspect of it. Yeah.
So life science chemical integration to our pyridine chemistry is basically we are producing acetaldehyde in life science chemical, which is transferred to pyridine business, right? So specialty chemical business. So that continuously transferred internally. Now coming to pyridine business future, as we have explained earlier also, that we continue to do value addition in our pyridine chemistry platform, and we continue to add new products in pyridine derivatives. And based on those new product demand, if you see, we are adding three multi-purpose plants because of the increased demand which we are finding from the global market. But of late, as we have also seen that some of the production of end product shifting to India is also giving us opportunity to capture more market share of our pyridine derivatives. Because of these two trends, we have taken decisions to augment our capacity in almost every derivatives which we are producing, plus launch the new product which we have developed where the new requirements are coming.
Okay. Thanks a lot for that, sir. That's all from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rohan Gupta from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Good evening. Sir, first question is on our specialty chemical business. So, I understand, sir, this quarter, compared to last year on your pro forma number, a lot of growth in specialty chemical and other businesses driven by the price increases. However, the EBITDA numbers on a specialty chemical business look flat. So, you mentioned that it has been basically the rising input cost probably which has impacted the EBITDA margins. So, just wanted to understand, if you can just quantify the kind of volume growth we have seen in the current year in specialty chemical business on YoY basis, and what can be the sustainable margins in specialty chemical business going forward, sir?
So we have mentioned that in specialty chemical business, YoY, we have seen significant growth. But you are right that in the last quarter, Q2, there has been very, very high volatility in the input prices. And as you know, specialty chemical businesses, this is not a spot business always. So there is a little time lag to pass on the price increase. But we are very confident that that all our cost increase, we are going to get from our customer. We are working very closely with customers. But we can only tell you the demand of specialty chemical is strong. and we continue to see a good traction of our volumes in specialty chemical business, and we are confident to pass on the cost increase which we are seeing. Of course, this is very volatile, but we are very focused to pass on this cost increase.
Sir, 17% is specialty chemical business revenue growth Y-on-Y. Sir, would it be possible for you to share the price-led growth and the volume growth for the quarter?
I think
Rohan, majority of Y, this is volume-led.
In Y-on-Y, we have seen both volume growth as well as price growth.
Okay, so it is not that only price increase 17%. There has been some volume growth angle also.
Yeah, absolutely. Correct.
Because of what we have seen, that definitely the commodity chemical, the input prices, acetic anhydride, high acetate, all those prices have gone up sharply. So what it looks like that is specialty chemical, all the growth is only coming from the price led. But you said that it's driven by both volume as well as price. So
Absolutely. If you see year on year, there is a volume growth significantly in specialty chemical along with the price.
Okay, so it means that when there has been volume growth, but specialty chemical EBITDA on Y-on-Y have not increased. So it's only because the price increase will come with some lag. So we expect that going forward in the second half, there should be margin improvement should happen and should get reflected in specialty chemical business. Am I right, sir?
We really can't comment on margin percentage, but definitely on absolute EBITDA, it has to be, we should do consistent performance, definitely.
Okay. Sir, second question is on the life science chemical business. So you mentioned that definitely, and also in your opening remarks, you mentioned that in general, we are benefiting from the current situation emerging from China. I think that you referred to the power crisis in China. We are not much dependent as far as the raw material is concerned coming from China, but we benefit from the end product pricing. Sir, can you just share a little bit more on that how is the current scenario? And we have seen that the ethyl acetate and acetic anhydride prices are continuously moving up. So if you can just give us a current scenario in a current month for the prices. And we are also seeing the acetic acid, that is a key raw material for us. There also the prices have started moving up significantly. So if you can just share a little bit more on that, sir, how will be impacted in the spread of our life science business in the current quarter or in the current scenario?
Yeah. So in life science chemical business, as you very rightly said, we have no dependence on sourcing part from China. But you are right that the only impact we find because of China disruption is on the prices of acetic acid. And as and when there has been disturbances in the global market and production in China, this price of acetic acid has been volatile, which we all are experiencing. But other than this price of acetic acid, the volume growth and volume demand of anhydride and ethyl acetate is absolutely not because of China disturbances. Volume growth is a very normal growth which we are finding in India for anhydride and ethyl acetate both, which we have mentioned earlier also in the calls that we had taken a decision to add capacity of anhydride because of the demand growth in India as well as global market. And nobody else is adding capacity. So the except for the fact that acetic acid price will be volatile based on the global environment, the demand of anhydride and ethyl acetate will be continuing to be strong because that is depending on the various end product demand, which is in India as well as in outside India, but not depending on China. So if acetic acid price changes, just like if price goes up, obviously because we are a large producer, we gain in terms of our overall profitability. So that is the only change which happens from this disruption. Else the market situation, the market demand is all actually very sustainable. And that's the reason we have taken a decision in the past to add capacity. We have also taken a decision to add one more capacity, which will be coming up in the FY22. I hope I have clarified that.
Yes, sir. Very much. Sir, another question is on our long-term strategy, and especially the new chemistry which we are going to commission in Q4 FY22, especially in Decatine. If you can, we are just, I think, Q4 is just only a couple of months away from here. So I just wanted to understand, sir, how you see that the customer's engagement with the company in terms of, I still believe that there is still restriction on a global travel. In that kind of scenario, do you see that the customers are still able to audit the plant, and when we commission our Decatine plant in Q4, there will be significant ramp up immediately in our that plant, or because of the pandemic issues, we will see some delays in commissioning of those plants or ramping up of those plants? So.
No, I can tell you very clearly, there is absolutely no impact of pandemic with respect to the delay in commissioning of the plant. We are almost close to start commissioning in the Diketene plant. So I don't think there is going to be any further delay on that. On your point of customer engagement, even during the pandemic, our customers have been doing audits virtually. So most of the customers in India are very much aware, very, very much knowing us. They have visited our sites in the past. So if they are not visiting for last 6 months or 1 year, they are not worried about our situation on quality and compliance. Just on virtual audit, they are okay. Most of these customers, for your information, are already our customers. So, you know, you name any agrochemical or pharmaceutical customer in India, we are supplying 1, 2, 3, or 4 products to them. So for them to approve us for a new product like Diketene is not a big challenge, because they know Jubilant, they have already experienced us supplying very high quality and very, very chemistry-driven product in past. I think that's not a big challenge. And with regards to demand situation, we have already mentioned in the past, with regards to Diketene, already there is an import volume happening to the tune of 15 to 16,000 tons on annual basis. So the volumes which we are targeting in phase one should not be a challenging for us to place as quickly as possible.
Sir, I completely agree with the point in terms of clients. The profile of the client doesn't change much because we have already been engaged with them. But my whole point was, because we are getting into new chemistries and the new products based on the Decatine and the new chemistry. So I understand, though definitely we have proven track record in pyridine and value added in pyridine, but definitely still getting into new chemistry. So probably customers wanted to probably see on a sampling basis or on a trial basis, definitely wanted to do the trial runs with us when we are getting into new products. So if just wanted to get more comfort on that, which you already clarified that it is going as per the schedule. Sir, with that proximity of the completion of this Decatine in just next quarter, sir, can you give some sense that from the current customer engagement and the kind of product approval which would have already happened so far now, what kind of additional revenues are you can expect from Decatine and new chemistries in FY23, sir?
So FY23, we are very confident to place our capacity which we are building up, because we plan to have phase two startup immediately after we finish the commissioning and place the volume for phase one. So we are very confident that FY23 we should be in a position to place our capacity whatever we are building up, and we have very well planning in terms of product wise, customer wise, where we will sell. So FY23 we will be in a position to place our volume which we are going to produce.
Okay.
And the capacity for this particular phase one, we have already told you, it is in the range of 6 to 7,000 tons, which we are also looking at how to debottleneck it further to see if we can increase it further. So we are working on that.
So out of the roughly 30 to 35,000 tons market, in the first phase, we are already going to have roughly 7,000. That's almost close to 20% market share we are targeting just in the first year itself of the commissioning of the Decatine plant, right? So,
yeah, but that's easily possible, no? Because that import is happening and these products are, the Jubilant is well known, our quality is well known. Nobody wants to hassle of import every time, and we can supply on time. Plus, you are reading about anti-dumping duty on these, some of these products. So
all those hassles, looking at those customers are happily looking forward to for our products. So if it was any other thing, then probably we could have discussed that. But here, I don't think that should be a challenge.
Thank you. I would request Mr. Gupta. I'm sorry, Mr. Gupta, to rejoin the queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Tarang Agarwal from Old Bridge Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Good evening. Thank you for your time.
Hi, Karan.
Yes. Three questions from my side, sir. Just wanted to get a sense on, you know, how your contracts are generally structured with your customers in the specialty chemicals business. Are they take or pay, or in terms of pricing, in terms of volumes? Just to get a sense in terms of your ability to eventually, you know, regain the north of 20% EBITDA margin territory.
Okay. So most of our product in specialty chemical, particularly the fine chemical and crop science chemicals, we are in domestic market, we work on quarterly basis, right? So we agree on a quarterly price and quarterly volume. On export, specifically in Europe and US, the customers are asking us to commit volume for annual basis and also price on annual basis. But obviously, with those customers, we have an understanding that if there are significant increase or decrease in pricing, they are considering our request to really revise that. So, and that is the reason it takes little time, lag, to get into the revised pricing based on the impact of raw material price. But we don't have any take and pay type of contract with any of our customers in fine chemical, crop science chemical, or even in CDMO. So CDMO is mainly the campaign based annual order and annual price, which is more or less, you know, we commit on campaign basis. So I don't think we have any take and pay situation in any of our product in specialty chemicals.
Sure. Thank you. So my second question, if I look at your industry end use split, about 245 crores of your revenue is from customers operating in nutrition. When I look at your nutrition and healthcare business segment split, the revenues are about 179 crores. So, you know, there's a balance of 66 crores of revenue that is coming from either the life science chemical or specialty chemicals business. So if you could give us some granular sense on what products are these and which of Jubilant segments is this 66 crore revenue attributable to?
So we have some of the specialty chemical products which are used by the nutraceutical industry. So they are used as precursor of ingredients, right? So which are pyridine based. So we have those products which are also going to nutrition market. And that's why you find that percentage there.
Got it. And so my final question, you know, you've gotten significant traction in your North America and ROW geographies if I just compare them on a Q-on-Q basis. My sense is that has to do everything with your specialty chemicals and the nutrition business. Would that be accurate?
Yes. Specialty and nutrition are major. But in ROW, we also have life science chemical partly. But mainly, you are right. Mainly specialty and nutrition.
Got it. Thank you, sir. All the best.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vineet Gala from Monarch Networth Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. A lot of my questions have already been answered, but if I can push you on one more question on acetyls. I just wanted to understand on the direction of the absolute spreads, that is the EBITDA per ton. So as you mentioned that there has been, you know, increase in export prices during the end of the quarter, how do we expect the EBITDA per ton to behave in the medium term?
Yeah, so good question. I think off late, I would say last 3-4 quarters, we have seen, because the demand is shifting towards India, particularly on this paracetamol and agrochemical and other products on anhydride and ethyl acetate, we have seen the per kilo margin also of our product improving quarter on quarter, which is a very positive sign, and we realize that that should be a more or less good scenario for future. Because as you know that we have increased our capacity 1.5 years before, we are adding one more. So we have huge volumes available to service all the increased demand in domestic market. So obviously the demand has gone up, and we are amping up the capacity. So we have seen little bit improvement in our per kilo margins as well.
Okay, but just to clarify, the per kilo increase in the EBITDA, the absolute EBITDA, wouldn't be, in proportion to the overall increase that you've seen in acetic acid, right?
No, that is, when we say per kilo, then it is after taking care of that increased price of acetic acid.
Right, but numerically, the top line would increase at a much faster pace.
Obviously. That's what Prakash was trying to explain, that even though our per kilo margins are improving, but the top line is improving faster. And that is a temporary phenomena, as you all know, because top line is not only acetic acid price, it is also coal, it is also other raw material, utility, freight, everything, right? So everything is going up. So therefore, you see the margin impact.
Fair enough, sir. So my last question is on, if you could throw some light on DODSIP incentives. So I understand that, the rates have not been formally announced, but what is the sense that, what is the benefit that we can get on the consol basis? And also, just one clarity, if these benefits are going to accrue on a retrospective basis since the cancellation of NEIS exemption?
No, so RODTEP, as you know, is not still announced for any chemical product.
Correct.
So whatever MEIS we had already claimed, and some MEIS has been realized in last quarter also as a cash flow, but we have no RODTEP anything pending now for future.
Right, but there would be some rate effective 1st of January, right, sir?
We don't know. They have been talking about 1st of September, then earlier they have been talking, so we really don't know. But yes, if it happens, then obviously that will be in addition to what we are currently have.
Fair enough, sir. Thank you, sir. That's it from me.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Varshit Shah from Vito Capital. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Pardon if my question is repetitive. My line got dropped off. Sir, my question is dialing back to your life science chemicals business. If you see the Q2 performance, actually the margins have improved out, although the margins sometimes have been volatile in that segment. So is it purely increase in your gross margin related, so the selling price increasing faster than your cost, or is there some operating leverage benefit is also coming, because I think we have seen some increase in capacities? So just wanted to see, understand, is there some significant portion of the operating leverage also playing out in a life science business?
Yes, you are very right. If you see quarter on quarter, we are improving on capacity utilization of the new plant, and our volumes have grown both year on year and quarter on quarter. And at the same time, I explained in my last question that we are also, because the demand is growing, we have a situation of better margin in these products. So both together is showing a better performance.
Sure. And one more extension to that question is that you alluded to the increase in paracetamol manufacturing, etc., leading to improvement in acetyl EBITDAs, absolute EBITDAs. So let's say over the medium term, looking beyond six months or even three quarters, do you think that these kind of EBITDA, improved EBITDA absolute, is largely sustainable in a broader range, and given plus minus the normal volatility? Do you think that kind of margins are sustainable on an absolute basis?
If you would have asked me this question last quarter, of course we answered no, but this quarter we have more or less normalized. But you never know the market situation. But we are confident that in near future, at least few quarters, things should be stabilizing rather than making further disruption. So we are
looking at market to be more stable. As I said, that more or less, more and more volumes are shifted to India, so the customers are well settled. Unless we see an end market disruption very badly, then we can see some changes, but which is not visible at least to us in global market for next few quarters to come.
Sure, that's really helpful. And just one last question as an extension to that. So, sir, overall, apart not only life science but across the value chain, if I were to see some of the competitors as well as my own research indicate that all these prices should stabilize of most of your products in Q3 itself, or probably it has already stabilized. So actually, Q4 onwards, the margin should look more stable on a quarter-on-quarter basis. Is that some kind of visibility you are seeing, at least sitting as on today? Of course, I mean, things are subject to change tomorrow, but sitting as on today.
I don't know where you are seeing a stabilization of input prices. In fact, as late as last week, we are seeing huge price increase in every raw material. So it is very difficult to say things are going to be stabilized in next quarter, because what I can tell you is that this disruption of China, which has happened in last 2 months, probably it is my personal guess and my personal experience is it may not correct before December, because they have some plan of Olympics in December, January. And they have given that cut of power and energy conservation in guidance to the country. So I think 3-4 months, I don't see big changes. Of course, slight correction here and there will continue, but not going back to normal situation in next quarter.
Sure, that's really helpful. I'll get back in the queue.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dhruv Muchal from HDFC AMC. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. So my question is related to the life science business unit. So in the commentary, you mentioned that there are some force majeure events for some of the capacities in Europe and China. But sir, given that India is largely, I believe, a net exporter for majority of our products in life science, so does it have any positive implication for us? And are these force majeure events temporary, or do you see them a longer term thing?
So I just mentioned about China that because of the energy conservation target and guidance they have given, they have also defined certain territories to be red territories. They don't want industry to run up after a particular percentage of production, because of which the input price, as I mentioned, is acetic acid, is really going to be volatile. That is what we are expecting. And but other than that, I think the demand scenario within Europe, India and ROW for our products are going to be strong. So that will continue. But yes, the input pricing, not only acetic acid, but other raw materials also, not depending to life science, but there will be a volatility in these input prices.
Yes, I think adding to Rajesh's comment, there is a, Rajesh has mentioned that there is a force majeure in one of the European company for ethyl acetate.
Yes.
Okay. Therefore, the demand for ethyl acetate has gone up. Both demand and the prices have gone up in Europe.
Got it. And so, given... So from ethyl acetate perspective, that becomes a positive, because and the short term thing which is happening in China adds to that. Correct. So, and so the second thing was on your comment that you're not seeing a lot of capacity additions in these kind these products. So is it something which has changed structurally, or any particular reason why people are not adding capacities, given that, as you mentioned, demand is growing, but we don't see a lot of, as you mentioned, there not much of capacity addition. So what could be
the reason of that is that anhydride and ethyl acetate is solely depending on acetic acid. And acetic acid, most of the capacities are available now in China or in Southeast Asian countries. Now, there is no additional acid capacity which has been announced in past or is being announced now, either in Europe or US. So because there is less availability of acetic acid, nobody is encouraging to add capacity of these products in Europe and US. In fact, it is becoming more and more challenging now to source acetic acid in Europe and US. Most of the capacities have come down to this part of the world. And that's where we realized this opportunity and we took the decision to add capacity.
Okay, so when I was talking about capacities, so in US and Europe, the capacities are not getting added, but in Asia, you don't see that as a concern. I mean, there could be some capacities that can come.
Other than China and India, there is no one produces anhydride in this part of the world.
Okay.
The technology is not available as of now, but you never know what can happen in future. Nobody can say, but not a simple product to add on easily.
Got it. And so lastly, just if you can speak something about the brownfield expansion potential in these capacities. I mean, how quick can that can be, and is it about adding reactors and, you know, producing additional volumes, or it's a completely different setup? You have to go fully backward and put all the capacity. Some thought there would be helpful, just to understand how if the demand continues to surprise, how capacities can be added.
So this is not like any multi-purpose plant or add a reactor or add a column. This is a unique facility which requires a very specific technology and of ketene chemistry. It's a cracking technology which is not available at many places, not proven by other companies. So it's not so easy for even, you don't find many producers of such kind of equipment. Only those companies who can produce certain technological equipment, they are specialized into this. So it's not a general reactor additional type of plant.
Got it.
It's a good amount of investment if you see.
Sure, sir. That's helpful, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Rohit Nagraj from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. I hope I am audible.
Rohit, you are echoing a lot.
Yes, Rohit, may I request you to come on the handset mode, please?
One. Is it better now?
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So the first question is in terms of your long-term guidance that you have said that we'll be doubling our revenues. In that aspect, how much of the incremental revenues would come from new products?
Yeah. So if you see our new investor presentation, we have given that what capacity we are adding up for the new product and what capacity we are adding up from the existing plant. So this will give you, but in terms of our growth projects, if you see our growth project which we have announced, one is acetic anhydride, which is of course our existing product, but all the multi-purpose plant which we are adding up, mostly is for new product addition. So that will be in specialty chemical business.
Right. So, and in terms of margins, so incrementally when we'll double the revenues, would the margins be going up or will they remain at similar levels, I mean, historical margins?
So if you see our investment, we are talking about major investment in specialty chemical and nutraceutical, right?
Right.
Except one in life science chemical. Now that the major investment is happening in specialty and nutraceutical, and both these businesses, our margins are better. So obviously, going forward on a whole, we can see improvements in margin.
Right. And sir, just last question on this. So basically, we feel that there will be volume growth which will elevate our revenue profile. And that is primarily, as you just said to the earlier participant, that none of these incremental capacities are getting added anywhere in the world. That is a precise reason why we are expecting the growth. So it will be completely through volume side.
Yeah. So we are whatever we are giving the guidance is based on the volume growth. So it is very difficult to give a guidance on the price of input. So because that is changing, you know, because acetic acid price is changing every quarter. But yes, even if we are talking growth, we are talking on a current pricing level. We say if you take current pricing level, our volume will grow double. That's what we are saying.
Right, right. And just one clarification on the force majeure that have happened. Any chances of some of these capacities going out of the system or mothballed, or these will come back once the situation relatively normalizes?
So we have talked force majeure mainly in China, except one in Europe for ethyl acetate. One in Europe for ethyl acetate is more or less a temporary. It will come back. In China also, it is not a very, very long term, but as I mentioned earlier, it could be for a few months or maybe one quarter or a couple of quarters. But of course, after that, of course, things have to normalize.
Right, sir. Thank you so much for all the answers and best of luck, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Alisha Mahawla from Envision Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Good evening, and thank you for taking my question. While most of my questions are answered, I just had one clarification with respect to the CAPEX that you're doing. So for the three, four projects that you have identified in your presentation, and even in this call, the CDMO plant, the MPP plant, etc., the total CAPEX for this is 450 crores, of which we'll be spending 350 this year. Just wanted to clarify my understanding.
No. So 450 crore is the CAPEX we have approved so far. That is the investment. And 350 crore is the cash outlay in the current financial year.
Okay, but for these three, four projects that you have identified, there could be a need for incremental CAPEX also for the timelines that you identified that they will come on stream in FY23.
Now, let me clarify. The CAPEX which we have mentioned in our presentation, the value of CAPEX is 450 crore, which part of which we will spend in this year, part of which will be spent next year. But current year cash outflow will be 350 crore.
Understood now.
Shita, just to clarify it once again, what we have said is over next 3 years, we are going to spend around 900 crore. So out of that 900 crore, 450 crores is what we have approved, and 350 crores is our cash out overall.
Understood now. And just one last clarification, the peak revenue with respect to the 450 crores that you were mentioning earlier of 900 to 1,000 crores, this is excluding the Dicotine CAPEX that we're doing, correct?
Yes, this is excluding the Dicotine CAPEX. You are right.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for the clarification.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bharat Gupta from Edelweiss Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Good evening, and thanks for taking my question. Sir, my question pertains to the life science segment. So there, we have a market share of near about 66%. So just wanted to check that with the recent news which is coming on the anti-dumping front on the acetyl intermediate. So what kind of a benefit it can be having on the pricing front going ahead? And
so there the anti-dumping which you have seen is not acetyl product. It is basically diketene product.
Right, sir.
Yeah. So there is no anti-dumping which is being discussed in acetyl.
So on the 8 products which we will be entering, so there will be anti-dumping duty going ahead. So that will be a key positive
for
us, right?
So you are talking about the diketene derivative which we will be entering in one of the group of products, which is aryl, there will be anti-dumping duty. You are right.
Right, sir. And in terms of the pricing, like that will be domestically consumed, or it is also an export-linked opportunity which would be there in pertaining to diketene derivatives as well?
So most of our volume, I think I have answered this question in the earlier question, most of our volume of the phase one is meant for domestic market. Of course, we will explore export market for future, but as you know, domestic market is part of product to the tune of 15 to 16,000 tons. So most of our volume will be for domestic market. So obviously, the anti-dumping duty which has been announced will also benefit us.
And so in terms of the new products which we are entering, so if you look even on the EBITDA per ton basis, so that will be similar to what we are currently enjoying in the specialty chemical segment. Am I right in my understanding on that?
Yes, you are right. In general, yes, I can say it will be in line with that. It depends on product to product again. So, but on an average basis, you are right.
Really helpful, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Cinderella Thomas Carvalho from Centrum Broking Limited. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Sir, just one clarification. If we look at quarter-on-quarter prices, what is the sense that you can help us with in terms of specialty and life science segment? And how do you see this scenario from China and European region in terms of supply disruption improving, overcoming 2 to 3 quarters? And would that impact the pricing meaningfully in any way?
You are talking about specialty chemical?
Yes, sir.
So, on specialty chemical, because of this disruption and input price increase, we have mentioned earlier also that because the disruption was very, very fast, so we are taking a little bit of time to pass on, but we are very confident that we will pass on the price. Having said so, as I also mentioned that the volume shift is also happening to India. So therefore, we are finding the overall strong demand of our product, which is leading to our volume increase and volume related increase, revenue increase. And also because the demand is improving, our price is also stable. So we are in a position to make our EBITDA based on the current demand. But of course, that price increase, which has happened in input price, we are trying to take that advantage in due course of time.
So would you be able to quantify what kind of inflation in the input price we have seen? And
I can tell you in some of the products which everybody can see that solvents has gone up almost 150% increase, and some of the products like coal, which has gone up almost 200% or 150% of price increase. So input price have been very, very volatile, very unprecedented. In terms of numbers, it's very, very scary and very high number. I don't think we will be right now in a position to have the number exactly to tell you how much has gone up because of input price and how much we are getting in the price increase.
So as a percentage of raw material, basically, you know, to our sales. That's what I was looking for, but it's okay. And so on the overall product pricing, in terms of we are emphasizing on volume growth, but what I understand is that current scenario has some disruption advantage from our final, right? Do you see that coming back to normalization, given that you expect certain to come back in China as well as in Europe, or at least specifically over coming 2 to 3 quarters, as you were mentioning in your earlier comment?
I'm not sure if I heard you very clearly because in between your voice gone, but I could understand what you're asking. I don't see in specialty chemical we have any situation which is one time require demand increase. I don't see any reduction in future. In fact, if you see the last year, same quarter Q2, we had a little positive scenario because we had come out of COVID in the second quarter. We had some positive scenario last year, which has actually normalized this year, quarter two. So I don't see anything which we have seen in quarter two, which is exceptional or one time. It's a strong demand, which is increasing continuously. I don't think there will be going back on volume reduction in specialty chemicals.
Thank you so much, sir. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rohan Gupta from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Sir, thank you very much for the follow-up. Sir, just a couple of questions. As raw material, acetic acid is a key raw material for us, and it's a very important for our life science business. So you mentioned that there are not much global capacities coming in acetic acid, and India and China just remain the key manufacturer of acetic acid. So with the rising requirement of acetic acid for you, do you have any plans to go into captive manufacturing of acetic acid, or you think that that enough availability will be there and you will be completely dependent on outside purchase?
So first of all, I will correct. I said there is no additional capacity coming up in Europe and US, but in Southeast Asia, we have good capacity available. But and it's also in China, there have been additional capacity in the last 2-3 years, but operating rates are very low because of disruption in China. Now, coming back to your question on can we produce or should we produce? Yes, we have the technology, we have the capability, and we also have announced that we are starting the food grade acetic acid. And we are evaluating the option to see if we can produce. But as you know, our route of production is from renewable source, which is ethanol, not from petroleum route, which is what normally people produce. So therefore, to look at large volume for future, we will have to evaluate whether it will be beneficial for long term. So that evaluation we are doing, and maybe if we see some consistency, then we will come back to inform you. So we have capability, but of course, we can't say that unless we are sure that the acid price in long term will be same, which nobody can say. If we are sure about it, we have capability to build on capacity of acetic acid. But if price goes down, we don't want to come to a situation where we regret later on. And that's what we are evaluating right now.
I said also in the current quarter, the net debt being as low as almost 193 crore, and I believe that in the second half, the company will generate further cash, probably looking at debt-free balance sheet by end of the year. So even the last quarter, I mean, Q1 con call, you mentioned that definitely company has already benchmarked the 950 crore rupees capex. That has already been decided by the board, but there is always a possibility to top it up with the further capex if there are further growth opportunities in the management sheet. Just wanted to know and clarify, is there any further thought process in topping up the capex plans and over the next couple of years, going a little bit more aggressive what we have already planned, given our free balance sheet, debt-free balance sheet, and solid cash flow generation. So,
yeah, Rohan, if you remember, even in our earlier discussions, I have informed you that we have a good pipeline of product further into our system. And looking at the market situation, we are going to quickly look at some of the expansion plan to expedite faster. And some could be the repeat, like phase two of diketene, we will expedite, you know, and we have some new products which we are planning to bring it to next year. Probably we will expedite to do it. So we are working on it. Give us some time. We will probably come back at the right time to announce further expansion in our investment.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So just a last clarification from our side, sir. Sir, on our standalone consolidated number, there is a basic difference between the life science chemicals and the EBIT contribution from the life science chemical business. So it seems that on our subsidiary, we are incurring some losses, especially in the life science segment, given that our standalone and consolidated operation. Sir, if you can just give some clarification on that, thank you very much.
So, Rohan, this is Prakash Deshpande here. So I think see the numbers on H1 basis, so you will get your answer. So on a quarter-on-quarter basis, sometimes there can be some transfer pricing adjustments. But if you will see the H1 numbers, you will see that they are consistent. So we are not making any losses. But
when
they get a fixed margin.
Okay, so that is just more of the accounting differences rather than any subsidies.
So then you will see H1 numbers, they will be consistent.
Thanks, sir. Thank you for clarification. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prati Kothari from Unique CMS. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity. So just in continuation to the last question, if you compare the at PBT level between standalone and consolidated, there's a massive difference. I mean, quarter one we saw from standalone to consolidated a 40 crore profit at PBT level, and here we are seeing 20 crore of loss.
If you see again H1, if you see the H1, there is a profit. So you must appreciate that the subsidiaries are trading subsidiaries, and then they get only trading margin. So that's on a quarter-on-quarter, there are certain accounting adjustments. Otherwise, H1 number is consistent. If you would see that there is a profit that has been generated by the subsidiaries also and the standalone also.
Okay. Fair enough. Sure. Thank you, sir, and all the best.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Thank you so much for the conference call. And if there are any further questions, our investor relations, and we'll be happy to answer and coordinate with our CEO and CFO for any further clarifications. Thank you so much for attending this conference call.
Thank you. On behalf of Jubilant Ingrevia Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.